Thank you very much, Marjuka. Hi, everyone. So we are going to... It fits in really well with Emeline's talk, because Emeline was talking about platforms. And I'm going also to talk about platforms, but with another point of view. I'm going to tell you about what I humbly observe in the media industry when I look at what they do or don't do with their APIs. So just a word about myself. I started building APIs for French museums, and then I loved it so much that I thought APIs were a really cool thing. So I'm a consultant. I work on APIs, with APIs, mostly with the media industry, also with industry and insurance clients. And I also sometimes work with startups because it's so much fun. And I founded a meetup in Paris called API.culture to try to instill a bit of API culture in the, API culture in the cultural world. And then I have the pleasure of collaborating with the API Days team, especially for the Paris event. And I'm working with them on this new initiative called Women in API, so all women in the rooms. And again, congratulations to Marjuka for this really great lineup of women. I know how difficult it is to do, so any women in the room, come talk to me or to any of the API Days members. So why am I talking to you about media APIs, and why do I think they matter? Well, I think they matter just for one very simple reason, is that I think that API, that media matter a lot. Why media matter? Media are going through very troubled times at the moment. We know that they've been shaken by lots of things. And yet, media are very important because they offer to us authentified quality news. They offer independent opinion, and they can even, when it's needed, well, they should be at least, that's my belief, counter powers to big powers that, you know, govern us, like either a big company, and I know that, you know, the power of huge digital platforms, and the media are some of the voices that do and should, you know, raise against powers when they become overwhelming. So they can be and should be counter powers, whatever the power is. And also, we get lots of news and lots of things going on, and we are in an information society, and we've been for a long time, but let's never forget that even sometimes the news can be coming from everywhere and can be very quicker, but much quicker in, you know, some environments that are not traditional media, that the media do have code of ethics and processes, and it's a craft, something you learn how to do. So the media are very important, and really, I think it's always important to remind it that they are really one of the pillars of our democracies. And that's why, that's my firm belief, I think that we should cherish our media, and by cherishing our media, I mean being extremely critical to them when we don't think they're doing a good enough job, and also make sure that in our everyday lives, some of the money we spend on platforms and whatever, you know, digital bundles we do, we make sure that some of this money somehow goes back to them. Because that's one of the problems they've been experiencing in the past few years. Troubled times, as I was saying, because they've been losing advertising revenue, basically since newspapers that used to print paper and sell ads in those papers. We know the story. You know, they went digital, and the digital advertising model did not quite follow at all. And then, over the past 10 years, they've been really dependent on platforms. We all do this. Sometimes we hear that there's something big going on, and we think, we know it's going to be much quicker to go to Twitter to learn about what's going on, and maybe not to our traditional media. Maybe, you know, we have a membership with them, but we are going first to go to a platform. And they've become more dependent on them, and also what's been happening for them is that they've been running after the algorithms changing, and, you know, how do I appear? So they have to be there, and yet the platforms have been eating away also part of their revenue. And what's happened, you know, this whole thing makes that they have suffered from disintermediation. People do not go directly see them. People consume news wherever it comes from. And now, more recently, we've had this fake news, very big, you know, thing happening. And also the media themselves have been suffering from lack of trust. In France, where I come from, it's huge. It's really big. Most people actually say we hate the media because they are not counterpowers. They're, they don't work for the good of the people. So the media are in a very difficult context, but there's always hope. There are also new needs from us and from them, new uses and new models that can come from there. As consumers, because we know that we are going to consume news that come from everywhere, we need authentication of these contents. We need traceability. We all know this. When I look at a video that someone that I know has shared on Twitter, there's, who hasn't had this that you think, a few hours later, or maybe I should not have retweeted this. Maybe it was not, a really a trustworthy thing. So we need traceability and we need transparency. What is this news? Where does it come from? What if it's a media that I don't really know or a media I know? Who's, funding it? We need to be able to know. It's not for every piece of news every day, but it's very important in the landscape. And also, we need fact-checking tools, and the media as well, and the platforms need fact-checking tools. And to check facts, you need to have access to information. So, information needs to flow and get to the right person at the right moment. The media also can have a very interesting thing here is that because people don't go directly to them, and they've been somehow disintermediated by the platforms, they can also see that as an opportunity to reach new audiences. And there's also new models, and I call it everything is a platform, is that today, of course, there are like the big social networks, for instance, but if you're in your car, your CarPlay or a vocal assistant is a sort of a platform where you can add skills to your Alexa or whatever. And also in your browser, like a browser is like really a store. You go, you can add plugins and you have all these, hundreds of plugins. So that's something that media can look into as well. There are new ways for them to make their content flow to new audiences. So the research I've been conducted started when I worked for Radio France, the French public radio that were working on their API project, and they needed to know, what's out there, what do other media do? So I conducted this survey for them, and I interviewed some experts, either in the media in France and abroad, or outside the media in like IA companies. And that was quite insightful. Also, what we did with Radio France, because it was quite complicated for them. They are so used to having their own audience. We also conducted a sort of design thinking workshops for them to understand how people could be in a context where they would consume their contents without choosing really to choose, to hear to Radio France content. How do consents come to people, and how are people going to consume that? So the research I did concerns what we call legacy media, not the really new actors. It's newspapers, radios. TV is, to me, quite particular, at least in France, so I'm not really including it. And if there's anyone in this audience who works on TV and on TV APIs, I'd be very happy to talk about them. There are some over-the-top solutions, but it's not really included in that research. And I consider it also press agencies and photo agencies. So no platform, although I did interview like some Spotify-like platforms and stuff, because they're very important in the landscape, but it's not really what this study was about. And what I found, my findings in this research, is today, how do the media broadcast their content? They still use very widely their own environment, their own websites and their own apps. And then they also broadcast through their long-time partners or big partners. And something very important is that those partners are not really always chosen. In France, if you buy a mobile phone bundle, you get free access to like any sort of media. And believe me, in that model, the media are not the winners. So, but they still, they sort of feel stuck in this environment. They also broadcast through platforms, and as I said, there's always, running after the platforms who sort of keep up to date, not to be totally lost in that system. And they use, and they've been using really heavily RSS feeds and web services. And actually one of, you know, every industry have their sort of barriers to investing in APIs sometimes. And what I hear from the media is like, why would we need APIs? We have RSS feeds and it's really working really well. But that's part of the disintermediation things, that they send information out and they have no idea who uses it, if it's been used, if, you know, their credits are, you know, follow along the line, and, you know, they have nothing whatsoever. And they, of course, all have APIs, but usually it's, you know, just a sort of a better web service for their long-time partners. Few of them really have strategic and strong API strategies. So what I found is this old saying, API or die, or rather open API or die. And that was very interesting, that those who have open APIs, and there are not many of them, but they say it's fundamental, we need it. And for what? For to recruit good developers and to, you know, to keep, to be excellent, recruitment and excellence. For innovation, because they're in this really moving environment, media in 5 years' time will be certainly very different. So they need to work with outside people and with, you know, on vocal assistance and all these things. And also, obviously, to the ones that use APIs know how it helps them control the reuse. But what I found most interesting is that they said, before we had an open API, when we went to a big partner, you know, this thing where it's the strong party that tells the weakest party, you must develop to connect to me. And they said, whenever we had to negotiate with those, we started, you know, almost as losers. It was very difficult for us. Now that we have an open API, because those platforms, you know, it's in their DNA to go see the APIs, when they first come to the first meeting, they know what we have to offer, they know our condition, and it never, ever happened now that we're told, this is what you need, please develop if you want to, you know, have a partnership with us. So that was a very interesting learning, is that it's not all about technical, it's also about politics and, you know, relationships in power. Another very insightful thing, although I, you know, we all sense it, but it was very nice to go see AI companies that said, we all dream of connecting more to media content. It's our dream come true. It's natural language and we need it to train our bots. It's voice and we need also to train our, you know, AI that helps recognizing words. And conversation is really important because you know that bots can, you're working on how the bot is going to understand your question. But the conversation mode is very different, that when you and I talk together, we're going to, you know, talk and then at some point one of us is going to reply something that you've said like three sentences before and we both know what it's about, a bot gets totally lost. So they need conversational models and radio contents are amazing for this. They obviously need image recognition to train and train on, you know, to recognize images on extracting information and also estimating the relevance of contents. And on the other hand, the AI revolution is really helpful for the media themselves because audio contents, and that's quite new, just appeared in search results. Like audio was outside of these search engines and now it's in. On the other hand, you can listen to written content in your car or in your earphones because, you know, AI helped, you know, and it sort of, you know, adds value to the written content. Add to this on-the-fly translation and captioning, and it gives a big accessibility boost to contents, and also image recognition and indexing for whoever owns a very big, you know, historical image database that we all know are not indexed well enough. AI can really, really help moving forward quite quickly. So basically what we're seeing is that these two worlds really need each other, which is always good news. And I'll finish with a few models of open APIs which I've seen. So the names that I've given them are my own. One of them I call the Guardian model. It's the model which is to me the most general. So the Guardian does that, but they are not the only one. It's a generalist open API. The Guardian is a generalist newspaper. They talk about anything from politics to sports to food to whatever. So they have an open API. There are click to accept deals online. It's rather for non-commercial use. You can just register and start playing with the API. And then there's something that says, oh, by the way, of course, we're very happy if you want to do some commercial stuff with us. Talk to us. And I know that these APIs are really, what I was saying earlier, that it's really useful for a company. It's not a very big business drivers. The business happens offline, and then the APIs can be used, but the open API is not a very big business level lever. So the next model I really like is the one that I've called the Financial Times model. Their APIs are really much more business-oriented. Basically, what the difference is that the Financial Times is a very specialist, you know, newspaper. And so they market their content in a very clever way. They say, integrate our content to your company. So they address no longer, you know, very clearly companies. And they say, our content, because they are so, you know, interesting for you, are going to fuel and add value to your business. And they have a tiered offer. And the most complete offer even offers to go access the whole of the content, the whole of the article, and do data mining and use whatever content you need and do whatever you want to do with it. So basically they're telling the companies, I guess you've got to pay a price for this, you know, go use our content and you can really use it like we would or even better according to your needs. So that's a really business-oriented API. And the third one is the one that I call the Getty Images model. It's one I'm really fond of as well. Getty Images distributes APIs, and they've had for a long time a very integrated and powerful API strategy, because a few years back, it's not new for them, they integrated, for instance, into the Adobe Suite software. So any, you know, designer on the planet that uses the Adobe product, and it's most of them, can have access to all of the Getty fund and also the research tools and everything, choose images, you know, do whatever they have to do. And once it's, you know, they need to put it in production because it's validated, one click and they buy the image. That was the first step. But what I find interesting, and it's not really on their open API offer, but they did talk at the API days in Paris last year, and I thought that was very interesting. They also use their API for a total, you know, diversification of their model. It's no longer about selling images. It's about giving access, again, to AI companies, but they did that before the others, and say, you need, you know, really, really big, very well indexed image contents. Come in, have fun, and pay. So they're really using to diversify their business model. And as I said at the beginning, that's one of the points of media, that they somehow, their old model of just selling advertising has proved not as efficient as the past. So I thought that was a very interesting strategy, API-wise. And also, two things I'm mentioning is the video, and I guess that the podcast will be the same. It's what I call the portable business model, because, you know, you talk to a platform, and you say, what about, you know, monetizing video? And they say, well, basically, you just send out the video and it goes with a pre-roll. So it sort of goes with its business model. And freemium models that obviously you can use to mix with any of these models and do the first step being free. And then, you know, you start paying when you want richer or deeper or, you know, a more historical depth or something. So basically what I'm saying is that really media have a lot of things. APIs can bring a lot to media. They should really go this way more than what I see that some of them are doing, but some of them are only starting to do. So I think that APIs can bring a lot. It's all about diffusing content. So, you know, API do that really well. Thank you.
Thank you, Isabel.